I'm not sure if that. So I can't. I don't know. I'm sorry.
Good morning, everybody. Okay, for the first song, we're all going to sing Lord, I Lift Your Name on High. If everybody could please stand.
Father, thank you for allowing us to come here and worship you today. I pray that you would watch over us through the rest of the service and bless us worship in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning.
I'm on. I'm always on. I was born on. All right. I won't be here tonight. That's no big news. It didn't make the paper or anything like that, but I got Blue River, Kansas City meeting. Next week is Palm Sunday. We do take Palm Sunday seriously. We're marching to Zion. So be ready to march, okay? We're not singing that, but you get the idea. Gleaners meeting, deacons meeting coming up. Here's what I want to dwell on. Passover Seder. Number one, sign up if you're coming. How many people are you bringing? Two, I don't know how many have done Passover Seder, but it is a long reading, worship, evening, and a meal. We read what's called the Haggadah, means telling, and we tell the story. Seder simply means order, so there's a meal, and it has to be done in a specific order, and everything has a meaning to it. There's a lot of reading, a lot of involvement. There's washing of hands, serving one another. And so if you've not been to one of those, come. If you have, come. It'd probably been done just slightly different. But Passover Seder, celebration of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Of course, resurrection is coming up. And then a couple other things I put on the Mr. Alliance's meeting here, the 19th, Ring of Fire, 12th and the 26th, and Bible school. We have ordered some materials, and so you're going to start hearing a little bit more about that. Okay. This is the part I always forget. Did anybody have a birthday or an anniversary you'd like to share with us today?
Got two back here.
Two back here. Okay. Whose birthday? Xavier's.
Happy birthday.
Was there another one?
And we have an anniversary.
Oh, Kelly and Mike anniversary. They've been married, what, 2 years?
14.
14? Shoot, I was just a little guy when you got married. Okay. So, do we have an anniversary song? And a birthday song. Okay. Xavier? Yeah, I see you're getting your own pencil, so I don't know. I'm not sure why I'm here. You don't need me? Oh, and a pen. Okay. Happy birthday to Xavier. I will tell you, we had a birthday party at my daughter's, and we sang happy birthday to him, and he cried through the whole thing. He thought he was in trouble.
Birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear
Xavier, who's 2 years old.
Happy birthday to you.
Yay!
I'm snacks.
You're rotten. I don't know where your parents are. Okay, happy anniversary. 14. Somebody out there aren't even that old.
Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary,
Mike and Kelly, 14 years.
Happy anniversary to you.
Woo! Okay. I never they don't let me do announcements anymore. Where did you meet?
Walmart.
Aisle 9, is that where you pick up a date or what?
Maybe Register 9.
Register 9, I think. No, I think it was Register 3. It's somewhere on the end. Yeah.
So one of you worked there?
We both worked there.
Oh, you both worked there. Okay.
I was her customer service manager.
Whoa.
I was a cashier.
I'm not going to ask you any more of those questions.
That's a long time ago.
Yeah, long time ago. Hey, we all started somewhere. It's all right.
Congratulations.
I'll give this back to Mike.
Would you want to take your snacks? He's happy. He's happy with his pins.
All right, I think for the next song, we are going to sing Soon and Very Soon, Medley. We've done this a little while back, and sing along if you know the songs.
Soon and very soon, We are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the glad morning when this life is o'er. I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away, I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away in the morning when I die. Hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away. To a land where joy shall never end, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Oh, they tell me of a home far beyond the sky. Oh, they tell me of a home far away. Oh, they tell me of a home where the storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Of cloudless days, oh, the land of the cloudless sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where the storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Will the circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky. I've got a home in glory land and outshines the sun. I've got a home in glory land and outshines the sun. I've got a home in glory land and outshines the sun. Way on the blue, Lord, oh dear Lord, oh do remember me. Lord, oh dear Lord, oh do remember me. Lord, oh dear Lord, oh do remember me. Way beyond the blue, I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away in the morning when I die. Hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
Praises, the only one I have for sure, Boy Lawson, surgery is scheduled for April the 3rd, I believe. I've written it down a couple of places, I think that's right. And it'll be at Menorah. Yes? Yeah. Wow. Okay, now that's shut off. I can hear better. Norman Willis, triple bypass. Jeannie Weatherman, removed part of a lung. And there was a... Melissa Smith. A scope, is that right? Okay. All right. Yes, Rosemary.
Donald's older brother is on hospice. If he makes it to May, he'll be back to May.
What's his brother's name?
Glenn.
This is Glenn?
Glenn.
The war hero?
Yes.
Oh, my. I say that seriously. Glenn was on a ship in the Pacific that was sunk. And you can look this up on the internet. And I did, the day Don told us the story. And he named the ship that went down. They were rescued by another ship, and it was sunk. So he was on two ships that went down in the ocean, and he lived through it. So that's Don's older brother, Glenn. Quite a war hero, I'd say. Quite a man. Okay, he's on hospice. Don?
Not feeling well.
Okay. Okay. What do they do? Do you know? Adverse effects have been already, yeah. Pleasant Hill. House, Glenn Osborne, hospice. What's that?
His name is
Frank. There we go. Again. Glenn Osborne, Melissa Smith, Jeannie Weatherman, Norma Willis, Boy Lawson. Just a sec. Have you heard anything about John Davis?
It was about the same. Yeah, that's what I got. Okay. Cheryl? Normal. I've never been told normal. Good news. Thank you. Yes. Who's this? I'm
the Kennedy family, the standoff resident.
Oh. Kennedy family. Okay.
I actually brought him to church.
Right, yeah.
I've been brought to them since they were kids.
Okay.
It's really hard on them.
They made the news.
Yeah, I know.
Okay, Kennedy family, a miracle, change of heart, deliverance would be the word I'd have. Okay. All right. Yes?
A praise. He took Xavier in for his 2-year-old checkup, and the nurse that was waiting on us was the nurse that took care of him in the NICU. Mm-hmm. And she said she took care of him for the full time he was in the NICU. She said she just sat there and rocked him the whole time he was in the NICU.
That's why he's rocking.
She didn't think she'd ever see him again. So she did his health checkup and went out crying and said, made her day.
God good or what? That's one of them coincidences. I don't believe in coincidences.
Did they say they wish he was just more mobile?
Yeah. We're not sure how healthy he is. Because we can't catch him. Oh, yeah.
Keep my grandma and family in prayer.
Yes. Norma Brewster. Hospice. Okay. That's a lot.
April 24th, she'll be 94.
Glenn will be 99. He's amazing. That is amazing. Yes, Diane. Okay. Diane May to see a heart specialist. All right. That's getting to be a long list, folks. I think we need to be a people of prayer. Just saying. Anybody else? Okay, so everybody in here needs prayer, it sounds like. We know somebody that does. Give us a minute to pray. Pray quietly. And then I'll break in here in a minute and close this time out. But we do need to be a people of prayer. I mean, we've had a lot of fun this morning, but this is lives. These are lives. And they're people that we care for. So let's get before our God and bring them before Him. I always like to tell people, they'll say, oh, you're praying for me. That's so nice. I'm like, no, you don't get it. You don't get it. I'm taking you before the throne room. The creator of heaven and earth, and I'm giving him your name and asking for your favor, his favor. Take it seriously. He is God, and I have nowhere else to go. All right, let's spend a moment quiet, and then I'll close it out in a minute. Brother, I just want to say thank you. You are a good God. You're a God of love, obviously. First verse we've all learned, for God so loved the world. He reached into our lives out of love. Today we really need that. His word is clear, your perfect love drives out fear. It's a force that fear be gone. That we can rest in the hands of Almighty God. We know your word, come to me all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. The very long list of needs, and demonic activity and brokenness, Kennedy family, and it's not a news item, it's real life. It's people that are hurt, people are being tormented. We ask for deliverance. For Diane May and the heart specialist. Lord, you're the heart specialist. You're the one that converts hearts, changes hearts, fixes hearts. So I thank you, Father. You're the heart specialist. For Frank Kurtz and the finding out you have radon in your home, and I'm sitting there thinking in my own mind, Lord, I wonder if we should be checking that. That just reminds me of the devil. You don't even know he's there. And then it begins to affect you. For Glenn Osborne, and Father, I did go on about him a little bit, but he is a true hero. So we'd ask peace for him. He knows about suffering. He knows about fear. May that be far from him in this time. For Melissa Smith and the search for diverticulitis, Lord, that healing comes. Jeannie Weatherman in a recovery from surgery. And let's get out in front of this surgery for Norma Willis. 3 bypass. I'm looking for recovery already before it begins. Healing. For Christy and the family, they stand beside the bed of Norma Brewster. And like all of us, we don't know the day or the hour. Let's be faithful in love until that time. For Voy Lawson and Father, as he looks to the surgery that we knew was coming, let all be prepared. Father, we're surrounded by tragedy, and I think, of course, the news is the tornadoes of Mississippi to Georgia and loss of life. The world is full of tragedy. But our world is also full of the presence of a loving God. So this day, in the midst of our needs, we obviously don't deny them, but we bring them to El Shaddai, God Almighty, that he would resolve these. He would resolve the fear and turn it into faith. He would bring his word, we talked about last week, a rhema word, a word that would speak into every situation. We thank you for your faithfulness. Father, there's so many to pray for. There are people out there who don't even know you. We pray for them. for open hearts and minds, for opportunities to share the love of Jesus Christ. That's why we're left here. So let each one of us be that light, that city on a hill that cannot be hidden. We don't hide our light under a bushel basket. There's a hurting, lost, and dying world. Let us be that place of hope. Bring that word. Thank you, Father, for your love for all of us here. Thank you for anniversaries and birthdays, celebrations of the goodness of our God. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
For Offertory, we're going to sing The Lily of the Valley. If everybody could please stand.
Jesus, he's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see all I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow, he's my comfort. In trouble, he's my stay. He tells me every care I need to go. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He all my grief has taken, in all my sorrows born. In temptation, he's my strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken, in all my idols torn from my heart, and now he keeps me by his power. Though all the world forsake me, and Satan tempt me sore, through Jesus I shall safely reach the goal. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here, while I live by faith into his blessed will. Oh, all the fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna, he will hungry, so shall fear. Then sweep me up to glory, to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Father God, first off, I want to thank you for getting all of my kids back home last week with no problems. And Father God, I would like to have a blessing bestowed on this entire congregation. This is the greatest church family I've ever seen. And I thank you for that. And Lord, be with the pastor as he brings us a message. And please accept this offering and guide us in its use. And Lord, please help us to be what you want us to be. We ask this in your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Hey, Chapman, can you turn me on the guitar? There we go. All right, for today's special, I'm going to sing It As Well. So if everybody would like to sing along, please do so.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my Lord thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ has regarded my helpless estate, shed his own blood for my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glory.
I'm okay. It is well. All right. Much to the delight of many of you, we are through Ephesians. It only took 3.5-4 months. I don't know. I lost track. I was having so much fun. Today's message is out of order. We shouldn't be there yet. We haven't even had Palm Sunday. But I thought the message more fit the day than it does the date, if that makes sense. And so we're going to look at, and we're going to a place called Gethsemane. This is a battle. We've been talking about spiritual warfare. This is one of the biggest battles. You know, what little bitty history I know, you know, you think of something like Gettysburg or you know, Iwo Jima or the Battle of the Bulge and D-Day, those words come to mind. But the one that was for eternity was fought in a garden. So let's take a look at it. I have two passages. This is Matthew's version, and then there's Luke's. Matthew and Mark's are very close to the same. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." I was keeping score here. There's 11. And he brings them all and he goes, "Sit here." And then he says to three of them, he took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, that would be James and John, along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." So I got this prayer meeting over here of about 8 men. And now I got this prayer meeting here of 3. And then it says, going a little farther, he being Jesus, there's my third prayer meeting, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Couldn't you keep watch with me for 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray so you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, the flesh is weak." We need to be spirit controlled. He went away a second time and prayed, "My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away, unless I drink it, may your will be done." And when he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come, and the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." Luke's Gospel, Luke 22. Jesus went out, mark this, as usual. Oh, we've been here before? As usual. To the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. Maybe that was what they were thinking. Oh, we've been out here before. He prays. We snack, we go to the snack bar, we do whatever, and he prays. That's how this works. Maybe. On reaching the place, he said to them, "Pray that you will not fall in temptation." He withdrew about a stone's throw. Don't even have a guess on how far that is. It can't be 20, 30 feet. Beyond them, knelt down and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. I put that in there because Luke's the only one that brings that up. So I wanted to give you the big picture there of what that looked like. Gethsemane. It doesn't take a... There's nothing new here. There's nothing new here. This is an olive grove. This is trees, maybe little pathways, very rocky place. It's dark. You know, when I think of it, of a park like that, I think of a nice lit pathway, you know, maybe some swings in the background. That's not what's going on here. This is just a rocky hillside and a leveled off place here, and there's some trees and rocks, and they've gathered there. And it's called Gethsemane, and we already know what that means. It means a press or an oil press. And they would, obviously, they'd squish the olives and get the juice out of them. And what they could do, they would gather all the olives, and they could put them in a sack, and then they would just take a beam and roll over it. And the more pressure you applied, the more juice you got out, and you could run it into a trough and into a receptacle of some kind, a bucket, a pot. So the more pressure you apply, the more oil you get. This is the place of pressing. That's why it's Gethsemane. That's why he's there. When I think about, before we get to this point, when you go back and look through the life of Christ, and you go, well, there was healings. There were miracles. He fed 5,000, the blind see, the deaf hear, the lame walk. The demon-possessed are set free. This is a joyous time. This is wonderful. You just see the disciples and everybody just skipping along, right? It's all been... I started to say Guns and Roses, but that's not it. it's not all been roses. I'll just say it that way. I don't know why that popped in my head. I got to take my head out and wash it again. Healing, the words. Remember when they heard the Sermon on the Mount, they go, we've never heard anybody speak with this kind of authority before. Wow, this is great. But don't forget, in the midst of those things, in the midst of those beautiful things, there was always testing. It began with testing. We go back to Matthew 4. Matthew 3, he's baptized. Matthew 4, he goes into the wilderness to be tried and tested and proven for 40 days with the devil. What a great way to start your ministry. Here's your seminary degree. Go spend 40 days with the devil in the wilderness. And if you make it, great. And so there he goes. But that's not the only time. He had a life, it's there in your notes, a life of oppression, attacks. In Luke 4:28, remember they took him, they're going to throw him over the cliff. And I like to tell people this. I think society is still trying to throw him over the cliff. The neat thing of that story, though, is, to me, sidetrack. They call it a sidebar, sidetrack, whatever. He gets to the edge of the cliff, and what does he do? He just turns around and walks right through them. There's the church for you. They're going to take us out, try and throw you over the cliff. You're just going to go right on through. God is good. He's powerful. But he had this life of oppression. His authority was questioned. Matter of fact, they ask him straight up, where do you get this authority? And he goes, where did John Baptist get his? They go, well, we don't know. And he goes, well, I guess you don't know where I got mine either. It was something like that. A little paraphrase there. He was accused of blasphemy when he healed a young man and he forgave his sins. And they go, nobody can forgive sins but God. And he goes, so they call him a blasphemer. And where's his source of power? In Matthew 12. Where did he get it? Oh, we know how he can cast out demons because he gets it from the prince of demons himself. Yes, he does. And so his whole life was this. Every time he went somewhere, no matter what happened, the miracle happened. I think I got the next one on there too. Let me get this. Healing on the Sabbath. No matter where he is, there's always this little herd of Pharisees, Sadducees, scribes, and these people who are there to ask questions and stroke their beards and make comments. Everywhere he went, that would get a little weary. Now, if I'm Jesus, and everybody's grateful that I'm not, I would go, away with you. He didn't. He didn't. So this life is his life is a full life. It is a life of joy and power and peace and calling and all of those things, but it's also times of testing and trial. A man of sorrows, Isaiah 53, acquainted with grief. And so now we get to this place called Gethsemane, and the reason I wanted to say all those things was he's been tried and tested before, but not like this. This is it. This is the Super Bowl of prayer. No matter how many games you won, if you don't win this one, they were all for naught. Bad sports analogy? Probably. Okay, sorry. So, but this is it, all right? But I wanted to share this, and it's not in your notes. So if you're a note taker, you might want to scribble a couple of these down. Because he's about to pray in a way that they haven't seen. But whoa, 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 whoa. Yes, they have. Yes, they have. Hebrews 5:7 says, during the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries and tears to the one who could save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Luke 19:41, he approached Jerusalem and saw the city. He wept over it. Oh, if you had only known this day would bring you peace. And he cries over the city of Jerusalem. He was a fervent prayer warrior. And he still is. Oh, and everybody's favorite. This is the verse. Right after you learn John 3:16, you learn this one. John 11:35, Jesus wept. There you go. Now, if you didn't know a verse, you can go tell everybody, I learned a verse in church today. John 11:35, Jesus wept. Okay. But he did. He was a man of sorrows, a man of who knew grief, a man of compassion. Gethsemane, a place of pressure. Now, see, you got a little blank there. Feel the pressure. Feel the pressure. And I put it in there, of the world, monumental crushing, life and death. How many times you said, I feel like I'm carrying the whole world. He is carrying the whole world. He has all of humankind for all time right now on him. And I don't know what it looked like. This isn't in your note. I made myself this note. Feeling the pressure of the world between me and you stood Jesus in all eternity to keep us from hell. If he doesn't make that stand between God and us, we're all bound for hell. And I wonder if in there, while he's praying, oh God, Father, I want to do your will, and I know, but oh man, this hurts. He asked three times. He's wrestling. He knows this is his call. Three times or four times before we get to this point, four times in Matthew, he tells the disciples, hey, we're going to Jerusalem. I'm going to be persecuted. I'm going to get hung on a cross. I'm going to die. I'm going to rise again. He told them four times. He knows it. He can recite it without even thinking about it. But now in this moment, in the darkness of the night, alone, what does he feel? The pressure of the world. And this is what I wrote down to myself. I wonder if he had a vision of us. I wonder if he had a vision of children. I wonder if he had a vision of people of all ages, of all colors, and all those things, all over the world, being dropped into a place called hell. because somewhere in there, his compassion overcame his fear and his love and his joy and his peace and his power rise up. I don't know. I don't know what he wrestled with. But that was my thought. I thought, if you're trying to make a decision about something, don't you kind of play it out? Well, if we buy this house and sell this car and buy this cow, you know, whatever it is in your life, and you start walking through it, and what's the consequences? What's the cost? And so he had to think through that. The cost was him. The consequences was a lost world if he doesn't. And the consequences, if he doesn't, is a saved world. And so he's wrestling. That's a pressure I have never and will never have. So feel the pressure. The next one, feel the fear. The breath of Satan whispering his voice. Go ahead, Jesus. Don't do it for them. They don't even know who you are. They don't care. Serve me. Serve me. You ever seen the Passion of the Christ when he's in the garden and at the end he trumples the snake or whatever it is? There's darkness. Don't think Dogface ain't there. He's there. Oh, he's there. He sees this as his last hope to stop salvation. If I can get Jesus in this garden, get to it in a minute, but he's had victories in gardens before, you know. The pressure, the fear. Feel the darkness. Just the darkness. I can't picture it. But it's not a darkness of no light, no moon, no nothing like that. It's a darkness. My heart and your mind. And you see a place of no hope and there's no way out. This is a pit and all I see is darkness. And in this moment, Jesus feels the pressure, the fear, and the darkness, and then feel the depth of loneliness. I bring 11 guys with me and I can't keep them awake. All I ask them to do was stay awake. Can you guys not stay awake? I share this kind of analogy once in a while, but I've never been in the military. Okay, I don't know. But there are people who have to stay up all night and guard. It would not be good if they all went to sleep, would it? Well, that's what happened here. He comes back three times. Three times he prays, three times he comes back, and they let him down. Every time, guess what, Jesus? You're on your own. That's really what it says to him. Peter, James, and John, and all the rest, they don't get it. They don't see it. In a book, usually I save for funerals, actually, to quote from, A Grief Observed by C.S. Lewis, after he lost his wife and everybody's giving him these nice words, oh, she's in a better place, blah, blah, blah. He said, nobody told me about the loneliness. Oh, you know what that's like. If you grieve for someone, you just, no. Oh, man, he's alone. So he's in this place of struggle. Gethsemane is a place. It is a place of pressure and fear and darkness and loneliness. And let's go on down this place of struggle. There's an internal and external warfare. And that's part of that. This is being played in our minds, in his mind. Oh, boy. I was prepared for this. I was made for this. I came for this. And now this is here and it's time. I don't know. He knows. He knows what's coming. He knows there's soldiers coming. He knows he's going to be beaten, spit upon, mocked, crown of thorns. He knows all that. He gets it. So there's this struggle. Here it is. The two greatest battles of history were fought in gardens. In the Garden of Eden, I'm going to move quick through this. In the Garden of Eden, Adam chose to disobey God, bringing sin to the human race. See, that the devil's been in the garden before, and he won a big battle. In a world that was perfect, in a perfect garden, and they had everything they needed, and Satan come in and lied. Adam did not resist temptation, but chose his own will over the Father. We do not see anywhere in Genesis where Adam goes, well, I got to give this some thought. I'm going to go talk to my Father. I got to go talk to my Creator. I don't make decisions like this. No, he didn't do that. He said, I'll go my own way. In the Garden of Gethsemane, the second Adam, known as Jesus Christ, chose the Father's will over his own human will. The pain and spiritual misery of the cross awaited Jesus. It seems as though the internal battle was fought in the garden. That's where it was made. That's where he made up his mind. And here it comes. This is a place, Gethsemane is a place of decision. Just as Adam's decision in Eden affected all who related to Adam, so Christ's decision in Gethsemane affects all those who related to him by faith. It affects us all. It affects all the human race. What he decides affects the human race. Now it would be easy. It just came into my head. It's just like somebody asked the question. If he is fully God and fully man, he already knew what was going to happen. It's already decided, and there was really nothing happened in the garden. And I will say, I think you're wrong. I think the reason that it was documented this way in all the Gospels, there was a battle. But we'll get to why and what that means for us. A place of decision. All right? All right. That next one, Jesus falls on, he said, you can fill this one in without me, and prays. Abba, Father, everything is possible from you. Take this cup from me. Yet not what I will, but what you will. The cup of wrath that Jesus agreed to drink was a monumental act of love in action for us. Carrying the weight of the world, he drank the cup for us. What is this cup? Cups are mentioned in a variety of places through Scripture. There's a common thread of God's cup that he makes nations drink in order to pour out his anger. From Jeremiah, thus the Lord, the God of Israel, said to me, take from my hand this cup, the wine of my wrath, and make all the nations to whom I send you to drink it. What he is to drink, the cup he is to drink, is a cup of wrath. That which was supposed to be, that is to pay the penalty for all men, for all times. That's the cup. I don't want to drink this cup, but if you want me to drink this cup, I'll drink this cup. He knew he was going to drink the cup, right? Wrestled with the thought. The cup of God's wrath. That's the cup he drank. Jeremiah 25, what I just read you. Gethsemane is a place of victory. These will go real quick. He responded to the Father's voice alone. Well, I told you, who's there? Dog face. Satan.
Come on. Don't drink it. Don't drink it.
There's a voice. Because I'm not listening to that voice. And what other voice do we have? We have the one in here. This is our voice. Don't think you don't talk to yourself. You do. You think things out. You hear your own voice. And so he did. He disregarded that voice. And the only voice he heard was the Father to the Son. Carry out the mission. Finish the mission. And responded. He was resolute in the calling. R-E-S-O-L-U-T-E for you English majors. Resolute in the calling. And finally, he rises up. He rises up to the test and the trials. So our Gethsemane, he passed the test. He rises up. He said, let's go, gentlemen. Here they come. Can you imagine walking right into all these hundreds of soldiers that were probably there, knowing exactly what was going to happen? Get up, guys. Let's go. Come on. It's not like getting your kids ready for school. Prayer, our Gethsemane, prayer is created and matured through our relationship with our Father. When I grasp what Jesus Christ did for me, I want to know my Father. I want to know what he has for me. And our prayer begins to grow and mature. And maybe it started with understanding a few scriptures or reading the Lord's Prayer or something. And then sooner or later, it builds into a relationship. Prayer is sustained by continually seeking God. It's not a one-day event. It's a continual prayer. All right? Sustained by continually seeking God. And this fits today. Prayer is a weapon in spiritual warfare. And prayer is ultimately a place of victory. When you hear the Father's voice, just like he did, when you rise up to do what the Father asked you to do. Can you imagine when he, I don't know this. I've probably seen too many movies. But I could just see him praying. And we've all got the photo, maybe you don't have, one of those photos with Jesus at the top of the mountain and the moon shining in the background, you know. It's funny, he always has really long hair and blonde hair and blue eyes. But anyway, so he's praying. It's the third time. This is when he goes up and says, rise up, guys. We're going. I just feel like when he got up, he goes, I'm ready. I'm ready. Every chain, everything Satan had tried to throw at him, he just went, broke it. Like the Incredible Hulk or something, you know? You just get up and you go, I got it. We're ready. This is it. This is the moment I came for. I've heard from the Father. I've walked through it in my mind, my heart. Let's go. Let's go. Let's take them on. And off he goes. That's what I feel like. We need to fight battles on our knees and then translate them into action. As I often say, will we do more than pray? Yes, but not until we've prayed. Not until we've asked the Father. Will we do more? Absolutely. We can be confident that God will send support. Did he send an angel? Yes, he did. Down in Luke. In Luke 22, and it's about, I don't remember. It's over there on your... An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. He may not send you an angel, but he'll send you somebody. He'll send something to encourage you. Now, I'm going to, what kind of preacher are you? Well, I don't know, but I do know this, that I have a picture. David has a picture. And it's called Psalm 18. Talk about a rescue. And David tries to paint the picture of God coming. You're in your Gethsemane. You're in your place of darkness. You're in your place of loneliness. You feel the pressure. And David in Psalm 18 says, I love you, Lord, is my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, my deliverer. My God is my rock, in whom I take refuge, my shield, the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I called to the Lord, who is worthy of praise, and I have been saved from my enemies. The cords of death entangled me. The torrents of destruction overwhelmed me. He's painting us a picture. The cords of the grave coiled around me. The snares of death confronted me. In my distress, I called to the Lord. I cried to my God for help. And from his temple, he heard my voice. My cry came before him into his ears. Don't forget, your prayers are powerful. The earth trembled and quaked, and the foundations of the mountains shook. They trembled because he was angry. I have this picture that as God began to leave the throne to rescue David in this picture, and that the ground felt the presence of God coming, and it just shook. People would look and go, what's going on? Smoke rose from his nostrils. He's painting a picture of God. Now, obviously, it is a picture. Smoke rose from his nostrils, consuming fire from his mouth. Burning coals blazed out of it. He parted the heavens and came down. Dark clouds were under his feet. He mounted the cherubim and flew. He soared on the wings of the wind. He made darknesses covering his canopy around him. The dark rain, clouds of the sky. Out of the brightness of his presence, clouds advanced with hailstones and bolts of lightning. The Lord thundered from heaven. The voice of the Most High resounded. He shot his arrows and scattered the enemy. His great bolts of lightning, he routed them. The valleys of the sea were exposed. The foundations of the earth laid bare. At your rebuke, Lord, the blast of breath from your nostrils. He reached down from on high, took hold of me. He drew me out of deep waters. He rescued me from my powerful enemy, from my foes that were too much for me. And he paints this picture, and I'll probably get slammed for saying this, but when I get this picture in my mind that David's painting, it's almost like a Greek mythology thing, you know? It just, that's kind of what it reminded me of. But here it is. So when you're in prayer, you're in your Gethsemane, you're in that place of darkness, that place of loneliness, that place of decision, remember your God and his might and his power and his ability to rescue you. I don't know if anybody's in that kind of place today. I have no idea. But if you get there, there is a way out. There is a way. All right. Now, I have a little quote I want to read, a little paragraph. This is from a book called Arise from the Darkness, and it's written by Friar Benedict Gauchel. Okay? The book's called Arise from Darkness. It's paperback. I have one. Oh, Lord Jesus Christ, thank you for leaving me the example of your sorrow and aloneness in the Garden of Olives. Without that example, it would be so much more difficult for me to go on when there was no one there for me. I'm grateful for all those whom you have given me along the way as loving friends, and also for the charge you have given me to be a friend to others. But get this, but sooner or later, we must all go alone. There's always that place in my heart where no one can come but you. Without your presence, the inner solitude becomes oppressive, devastating, a wasteland of howling winds and dark nights. But when you're there with me, and only you can come there, my whole life is filled with light, and I can go on even in the midst of great trial. Be with me, Lord, in the dark time. Let me rise from the darkness because you are there. Yeah. I don't know where you are. Maybe it can be family, health, finance. It can be all the, I'm not going to try and make any more lists. But there's a place of intense prayer that we get to from time to time. And we have been there. I know me and Janice a few times. We just cry out to God. rescue, rescue, rescue me. The disciples did not understand the criticalness of the moment. And I think the Lord Jesus Christ would say to us today, do you understand the criticalness of the moment that you are now living in? Do you understand? Are we going to the garden and praying? Here's that place of Gethsemane for us to fight off the pressure and the lies of the enemy. I have one more verse. I shared this the other night, and it is, and God has tried to write this a little more on my heart. Exodus chapter 10. You brought your Bibles, didn't you? Exodus 10, and I'm going to say it's about verse 23. This is in the midst of the plagues. All right. Exodus 10. Then the Lord said, I'm going to start in verse 21, I apologize. Then the Lord said to Moses, stretch out your hand toward the sky so that darkness spreads over Egypt, darkness that can be felt. There's a darkness that can be felt. Jesus felt that darkness. So Moses stretched out his hand toward the sky, and total darkness covered all Egypt for 3 days. No one could see anyone else or move for about 3 days. Stop, think. Yet, all the Israelites had light in the places where they lived. The whole world may go dark. You can have light. That's how good your God is. That's how powerful he is. So if you're in your Garden of Gethsemane, that place of pressing, that place of fear, that place of pressure, today God can bring light into that place. Let's pray. Father, Gethsemane. Just the very word makes me, Jesus just crying out on our behalf and feeling the pressure of the whole world. And Father, I know there's times everybody here can say, I feel the pressure. I feel like if I make this decision, it's going to affect a lot of people. So, Father, wherever we are in that walk, number one, I want us to remember Jesus. Jesus took on the pressure and had victory. And so can we. Jesus took on the pressure to save us. He took on the pressure of the whole world so that we might be saved and live with him for all eternity. He also showed us how to pray in the midst of the darkness and the loneliness. And that is just to keep coming back to the Father. What you want, Father. Father, I never thought about this. He didn't come with a list. Jesus didn't come with a list with prayer requests. He just said, your will be done. And he submitted. So Father, there's times we just need to say, will be done. I submit in the midst of the darkness. Thank you, Lord, that you're with us. We are never alone. Thank you. Gethsemane, the place of pressing, the place of victory. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus, for fighting for us. Thank you for saving. Father, that might not even be near what somebody needed to hear. I don't know. And I don't know what everybody's week is like and how things are and the stresses of life. But Father, if there's any of us here, if we're being pressured into a decision, we'll receive some prayer and some guidance. We'll be surrounded by love. We thank you, Lord. You're a faithful God. And you'll be faithful in this place today. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. The worship team comes. You know how this works. We'll sing a closing worship song. It is a worship song. And if you need prayer, come. We'll meet you at the front. Or if you just want to come and kneel, you're free to do that also. You come as the Lord leads.
For time of response, we're going to sing Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. If you please stand. Thinking of us. Thank you for thinking of the whole world and every person. Knowing that without you, we're under the bondage and the weight of sin with no hope. With you, all things are possible. We are free. The chains have been broken. Darkness to light, from hell to heaven. Thank you. Father, this day or throughout our week, if we feel like we're in that place,
of Gethsemane. Remind us we're not alone. You are the great rescuer, and your hand is upon us. Thank you, Father, for your love as we leave this place. And as we know, all of creation rejoices with us. The trees of the field will clap their hands, and you shall go out with joy. So out we go with joy. Free, loved, forgiven, with hope. In the name of Jesus we go. Amen. Amen. Amen.